This talk has a lot of commonality with the previous talk in that I'm talking about sustainability from an energy point of view. And all of you have heard of the three R's, right? Reduce, reuse, and recycle. My lab, which is called the Smart Energy Informatics Lab, we look at all the three, these three R's and also three more. I won't get into that here. I want to focus on the one R, which is the most important, I think, which is to reduce the consumption, which is reduce. And I'm going to talk about three kinds of reduction. One is the consumption reduction. And that is to reduce the amount of energy that we use. And the mantra that we're going to follow for that, we've been following for that, is if there's no occupancy in a certain space, we want to have no consumption there. So no unnecessary lights, fans, ACs, and so on. Second is we're going to improve predictability of the from a viewpoint of production by flattening any consumptions which are peaky. For example, suppose you have a picture like this. Three kinds of profiles for consumption. This is a very flat, rather flat, slightly peaky, and very peaky. Now, peaky consumptions are very bad from a production point of view because the producer has to be always ready to pump in more energy into the system. And that means that he's going to have some standby generators, which are usually polluting. I'll come to that in a second. And finally, we'll also do reduction in terms of reliance on unsustainable energy sources. Okay? I won't get into this. I'll just focus on these two for now. And all of this has to be done with another sustainability in mind, which is the sustainable solutions. We don't want to put an intervention there one day and see that it's gone the next day. Second is we want to be also having equitable solutions that are feeding into this picture, into this problem. Now, we have built a smart energy consuming classroom complex in my department. So this picture shows what happens. So dark room, nobody is there. Somebody walks in, the lights turn on, and then the fans and air conditioning and the combination thereof, the right combination is chosen depending on the humidity, temperature, and other things. And so all of that is represented in this finite state diagram, which can be easily translated into this behavior that I'm talking about here. And this satisfies the no occupancy implies no consumption mantra. Now, we also go one more step and look at the schedule that we have for the classrooms. And we can convert this schedule into a newer schedule, which is going to take into account the pre-cooling that happens when you have a meeting in a room. And you want to capitalize on the pre-cooling and use the space that is already cold or properly climate controlled for holding another meeting or another class. Secondly, we want to also have room sizes chosen according to the occupancy of the particular meet for the required for the particular meeting. And we also take into account something called a gap hour, so that rather than turning off all the ACs, we maintain the temperature slightly higher than desired. And when the usage happens, just prior to that, we decrease the temperature. So that way you capitalize on the pre-cooled area, but not consume all the energy required to maintain at that temperature. All of this put together gives us a fairly large energy saving. This is for lights and fans, this is for HVAC, that is heating, ventilation, and air conditioning. This is a baseline. This is when 7 hours continuously the room is occupied, the room is climate controlled and lights and fans are on, which used to be the case. Now we have better baseline if you turn off the air conditioning and other things during the lunchtime. A smart one, which has some of the components of the solution. If you take a given schedule, you get this. And if you get a cleverer schedule by moving the meetings around, you get something like this. All of this can add up to a savings of 58%. And that is about 6 academic months of payback time. Very impressive, I think. We have been able to repeat this in other places also, including auditoria and my lab. So I want to show you the picture involving all of these things, including this smart door, which I hope the movie works.
Welcome to the Smart Energy Informatics Lab, where we manage energy computationally. Here we have the setup of the smart door system. It consists of 2 laser phototransistor pairs installed to detect entry or exit. An ultrasonic sensor above and a weight mat below measures the height and weight of the subject. The data gathered from height and weight sensors is fed to an AI classification algorithm for learning and predicting user identity. soft information like users' schedules and current occupants in the room is used to disambiguate between people having similar height and weight. Each occupant has his own set of preferred appliances which are switched on when he is in the room and turned off when he leaves the room. This helps conserve enormous amounts of energy while giving the occupants a personalized experience. Smart classroom complex consists of four classrooms where consumption occurs if and only if there is occupancy. Let's take a look at one of these classrooms now. The moment a person enters the classroom, a PIR sensor near the door is triggered and the lights turn on. Hereafter, image processing techniques like motion and skin detection are used to discern any change in the occupant system. A few seconds later, fans and air conditioners turn on based on occupancy, humidity, and temperature. The appliances in this zone are turned off since the zone was previously unoccupied. We turn off appliances in unoccupied zones, thereby reducing power consumption per room. If occupancy continues to be detected for a certain period of time, appliances turn on. We have calculated the energy savings of the smart classroom complex to be 48% with a payback period of 6 months, which is very attractive. When the system fails to detect human presence for 30 seconds, it infers a state of zero occupancy and turns off all appliances. Thank you for watching.
Okay, so those are two examples. We are also intervening in auditoria in our buildings and elsewhere in the campus. So what this is illustrating is that a simple idea of consuming less can be gotten from a very simple thought in that says there's no occupancy, there's no consumption. The other more technically interesting problem is to look at flattening of the unpredictable peaks that we have. That comes from cooling, which is a lot more energy consuming than lights and fans. So if you look at this, this is the usual cooling curve where the air conditioning or the HVAC tries to maintain a certain band of temperature starting from there to here. And cooling, as it comes down, takes a lot more energy at the lower ends of the temperature chart. So we want to avoid having to cool to a much lower temperature than otherwise. Now, this is the part where energy is consumed. This is the part where the energy is turned off, and the room starts to warm up, and the cycle repeats. Now, if you have two such things working together, in the morning, for example, you come into this auditorium, turn on all the air conditioning units, the peak happens. What you want to do is to have a profile which looks like this, which looks like a flat profile. But so you have to do this very carefully because otherwise the conditioning of the room will be affected. So to do that, we have something called the thermal comfort band maintenance algorithm for TCBM. For those of you who know TCBM from the Cold War days, this is not that. This is temperature control. What happens here is suppose you're given three air conditioners. I'll show you the picture here. And you can only have two to run at any point in time. What you can do is do schedulability analysis, very close to what we do in computer science, and make sure that the temperature will be lying within the band, even with two ACs running out of three. Now, if you look at this, which is a 5 AC case, we have two things to worry about. What's the ambient temperature? What are the comfort bands? And we fill this table with yes or no, telling you about whether it's possible to run just two ACs out of five and maintain the temperature within the band. And with that in hand, you essentially tell the customer that you can have a smaller requirement in terms of the peak energy requirement and still satisfy the quality of comfort in the room. Yeah, it'll be done. So now there's a question of how do you provide the sensing for this. And we have something called the observability criteria, and all of that is done through hard and soft sensing. A structure of the building is used to reduce the amount of sensors, and this relationship that we maintain between various parts of the building. For example, this is the four-classroom complex. You can use this fact that the two small classrooms contribute to the larger class and use that to minimize the number of sensors using the type of function that you want to compute and so on. a fair amount of technical details here, but the point is we can just use a combination of hard and soft sensors to reduce the amount of dependency on hard sensors, and hence the cost will be reduced. Now, finally, the point I want to make here, is that communication is very important. Our messages, we communicate very carefully. And this is where energy in particular suffers. We went to a large apartment complex in campus, you know, where professors stay and so on. We asked them, what are your thoughts about your bill? What's the cost you pay for energy? What's the peak? What is the profile? Whether it's like this or like that? And we found that 16 out of about 54 knew what the bill was. Nobody knew when the peak happens for the energy, and also what the profile is, whether it's large in the morning or the evening and so on. That is a very dangerous situation, because if even professors don't know what their consumption profile is, then we are in trouble, because we can't do any interventions which depend on the customers. So important thing is to have people allow you to intervene in the house or the apartment or the building and make the savings possible. What are the savings? Savings could be in terms of energy, could be in terms of rupees, or in terms of impact on the environment. Which of these numbers is important? I normally play this game in my talks, where I ask people, start with this and say, how many of you will come? If you come forward, I can save some amount of energy. Nobody does. This one, people start to move, because I think it touches their heart or the brain or whatever. Something is touched by that. And then the question is, how do you get these numbers? You get these numbers by having all these questions answered. This is where you need AI, because numbers don't come straight at you. You have to measure the base phenomena, infer from it all these questions that I asked you before. And that's where AI meets the energy. And so we have that. And these two also can be added with with some thought. We have done that in our labs. And I can stop here, because I've been staring at that card. Thank you. By the way, the other way of communication is to write blogs and also to publish articles in newspapers, which I do. So if you want to see the communication action, that's a good way to do it.